over the years in Fremantle and Cockburn. Certainly, a lot has happened over the years since the first of the sailing ships arrived in Fremantle in 1829 and anchored out in Cockburn Sound. Firstly, the long jetty was built to handle the ships of the day. Those ships brought out our early pioneers with cargo necessary for the development of our vast state. The first plan of Fremantle was drawn up by J.S. Rowe in 1833. Around the turn of the century, through the expertise of a brilliant engineer of the day, a C.Y. O'Connor, our Fremantle Wharf came into being. It was opened in May 1897. C.Y. O'Connor also masterminded our Goldfield water pipeline. Our state was in gold fever in 1893, but no water available in the gold fields. Yes, he successfully pumped water 563 kilometres from Mundaring to Kalgoorlie, and it still operates today, 100 years on. Fremantle Architects is a credit to our early architects. Beautiful character buildings, but if it was not for Sir Frederick Sampson, Fremantle Mayor for many years, a lot of it would have been demolished, but no doubt he would have had many supporters. So to them, thank you, as those buildings today play a large part in Fremantle's history. Let's talk about our state's happenings over the years. The convict area, Goldfields boom, and of course don't let us forget about the America's Cup challenge. A lot certainly has happened over the years. These points we will talk about later on our video. So let us leave views of Fremantle from the monument and travel to King Street, East Fremantle, and let's listen to two lovely ladies whilst they tell us about their Fremantle experiences of over the years. Today is the 28th of November 1997, and I am here to have a talk to a resident of East Fremantle of many, many years. A lovely lady I have had the privilege to have known for around 70 years of my life. Where does she live? King Street, East Fremantle. Ella Roberts will tell us her story of her life in Fremantle, yes, over the years. With Ella is her niece, Mrs. Lorna Sullivan, who also has spent her life in the vicinity of the city we all love, Fremantle. Ella, how did you come to live in East Fremantle, and what year?
I was born here, at where we live, and what was the other part of the question?
Well, what year would that have been? What year were you born, in other words?
1910.
Yes. That's lovely, isn't it? Lovely to think that you've been here all these years in East Fremantle. What about you, Lorne? You were born in Pally?
I was born in Aurelian Street, number 7, in 1931, September the 2nd.
Yeah, well, you've been around and seen a lot of Fremantle too, haven't you?
Yes, I
have. Yeah, that's for sure, that's for sure. Ella, your early days of growing up, such as your schools, your entertainment, where you worked, transport, doctors, hospitals, hairdressers. Let's start with the schools.
Well, the school was just up the road in the, what it was known then as the Plimpton Primary School.
You're still there?
And, yeah, oh yes, my word it is.
Still Plimpton?
It's still active.
That's lovely, because you'd have been in Pally School.
I was at Pally School.
Then I went on down to Princess Bay, which is a girls' school. They had girls and boys went to the Fremantle boys then.
Yeah, while you're on the boys and girls' school in Fremantle, Fremantle boys, that was built in 1854. And the Fremantle Girls was built in 1901.
Right.
So I'm glad you brought them points up.
Yes. Then I went on to technical school.
And that was Fremantle?
Fremantle.
Where it still is.
Technical college.
Yeah, there's a lot of personnel gone through those schools, isn't there?
Yes.
And of course, the Fremantle boys and that now is a film film contest.
Yes.
And what about Pally, Lorna?
Yes, I attended Palmyra up till about sixth grade, and then my mother was called back to work when the war broke out, and she worked at Pierce Brothers, and my brother joined the army, and I was very fortunate to have a grandma and aunt who lived in East Fremantle, whom I lived with, while I was at Princess May. I went up here to East Fremantle, the Clifton School, for a few years, and then when the war became close, the Princess May closed and Fremantle Boys closed, and the children were billeted out in churches and halls anywhere in the districts that would take them. Mm-hmm. You know, they were all sent away.
Yeah, that's interesting also. Now, what about entertainment? Did you used to go into Fremantle for entertainment, or was it
Fremantle, Wrightson's for dancing, and the Hoyts Theatre, Princess Theatre.
Yeah.
And then the Ron Jenkins was the had the band.
Yeah.
And was Queen's Hall in Palmyra there.
Yeah, that was on the corner of Petra and County Highway.
Yes, yes, that's all changed, isn't
it? Now what about you, Ella?
For entertainment, we had pictures, the theatres in Fremantle when I was growing up were the Old Majestic and the Palladium, the King's Theatre and the Princess Theatre. And generally we were allowed to go on Saturday afternoon in the winter. And we paid threepence then to go in. And we had a very comprehensive program. It was very good. And mainly covering the war activities that were on at the time, because I was only 4 years old when I used to go down there with my elder sister, Lorna's mother. And
it was 1914.
Yes. She was the youngest sister, actually, and we used to go over Saturday afternoon.
What about the Majestic? Didn't that finish up a coal store, nothing over 2 and 6? Can you remember that?
Many things.
The old Majestic in High Street.
I don't know what it is now.
I know there's an arcade right next to it.
It's Paddy Troy Arcade, isn't it?
I think so. And if you walk another 50 yards up and look back, you can see where the upstairs section of the theatre was.
Right. Yes.
You can see the shape of the roof. It runs on an angle, on a slope, actually.
And for other Saturday afternoons, we would go to and play tennis and usually across in the church clubs, and Saturday night we'd go and dance down at the old Vic Hall.
Yeah, well, I've got a memory of the Vic Hall, that's where I met my wife.
Yes.
What about Point Walter? Did you ever go to Point Walter?
Yes.
That was quite popular now from our family, and my dad yours too, Lorna.
Point Walter for picnics. Our activities were mainly dancing in the church clubs, and we would go on a lot of picnics. And
what did you do mostly to get to town? Catch the old tram.
Old tram.
Pretty close handy, wasn't it?
Yes.
Only 50 yards away.
Yeah. Trams, when I was quite young, they only went as far as Duke Street, and then gradually they went out further towards the cemetery.
Yeah, well, nowadays, didn't they? They went to the cemetery, then they changed it and went straight up Marmion Street.
Went up Marmion Street.
And what about doctors? If you got sick, did you have to go to Fremantle?
Dr. Dermer was the
in Fremantle.
Yes.
I think we were the same.
And then his son, Mr. Edward Dermer. Dr. Edward, he followed his father.
And of course the hospital would have been Fremantle, no doubt, wouldn't it?
And of course it was a lot of epidemics of, you know, typhoid and diphtheria, whooping cough, and of course eventually the immunisation came in and knocked it, the disease.
You did a marvellous job, didn't it?
Mm.
Did. Mm. Yeah, what about you, Lorne? Did you used to have to get the tram in Pally?
Yes, we used to go by tram into Fremantle.
And once again, you catch the tram, you had to go to the doctor.
That's right.
Fremantle was everything then, Dave. There was no suburb shopping.
Yes, there was no suburb.
Yeah.
Yes.
And all Charlie Carter's and Freecorn's and all those stores in Fremantle, but you've all gone now.
Yes,
it's
all gone.
Yes.
And what about if you wanted to get your hair done? Did you have to go to Fremantle for that?
Go to Fremantle. Yeah.
And what about you, Ella? Did you have to go to Fremantle to get your hair done?
Oh yes.
Your sister didn't do it.
The main hairdresser down there.
Mr.
Lovering.
Lovering in Fremantle itself, probably.
Yes, he's very popular.
Mm.
And then there was, who came next? Dolly
and
Spoon.
And generally the hairdressing was very plain at that time.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
You've got the American cut, you know, fringe across here.
Right.
Well, the girls were lovely enough. They didn't need to be...
They didn't need it.
And what about your groceries? Grocery shopping?
Groceries.
Local
groceries.
Store or...?
Groceries were... the boy came out and took your order and delivered it a few days later.
And where would the store be? In Fremantle or...?
In Fremantle.
Yeah.
Generally at Bennett and Burnside. They were a big grocer shop along in Adelaide Street, just up from High Street.
What was that name again?
Bennett and Burnside.
Bennett and Burnside. Yeah. Oh, you want to leave?
Yeah.
No. Oh, that's pretty good. And what did we do in Pally? Up the Stammers, I think, wasn't it?
Well, mainly old Bertie Blythe on the corner.
Old Bert,
down there.
You know Bennett and Burnside.
No, I don't recall it, Ella.
No.
That's where Freecorns and they took, you know, over after.
This was Freecorns and then, Fisher Beards.
Oh yeah, Fisher Beards.
Yeah, Fisher Beards.
They were on the corner.
Yeah.
And what about you tell me the story, Ella, of the bread carter.
Bread deliveries.
Oh, bread, they came to the door too.
A horse and cart?
Everything was delivered to the door.
Mm.
Nothing, you didn't have to go down to the town and haul home bags of groceries and... Mm. Get your milk and everything. The milkman came in the early hours of the morning.
Yeah.
And
what about your
meat,
butcher? Meat, yeah.
Meat was delivered. The butcher came around and you went down to the cart and chose what you wanted.
And you the postie would have been come though, would he? Did the postie come deliver once a day or something?
Twice
a day. Always good. Well, the postal service has always been good then, hasn't it?
Yes.
Really speaking.
Yes.
Yeah, that's very good. And what about the Iceman?
The Iceman too.
Yeah.
We had ice boxes and he came a certain dates, you know, and delivered what you wanted.
Yeah, I think the gentleman used to come out was old Bolger, wasn't it? A chap named Bolger?
Oh, yeah, from up the hill.
Yeah.
Then we had Adamini.
Adamini,
I know. They lived in Penno's house.
Oh yes.
And the woodyard there and young Joe had the ice round. Yeah. Yes, he ran the ice.
Yeah, that was quite a big thing in the early day, wasn't it? All the kids would be following the ice cart up the street to get a chip of ice.
Yeah,
on a hot day, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and of course the papers, I think, were delivered the same as they are now, weren't they?
Yes.
Paper was delivered every morning.
Yes.
Plus the weekend.
Or what kind. Yeah. Yeah. Tell me your experiences of Fremantle on New Year's Eve. I think everybody used to visit Fremantle, didn't they, on New Year's Eve?
Oh yes, it was all very orderly and very social. You'd meet people and, you know, chat away and probably go and have a drink with them and, you know, buy a lot of things that you couldn't well do without.
Yeah. What are you being a little younger, Lorne, what was your experience?
Oh, yes.
Well, I can remember parties and dances, you know, New Year dances and things like that. But everybody had parties, things going on, and it was all very, it was lovely. It was good. You know, and you'd go out and you'd know that you were going to get home all right.
Well, it was something to look forward to, wasn't it?
Yes.
It was a part of Christmas holidays. It was New Year's Eve was it.
Yes.
It was lovely.
It was very orderly and,
nothing frantic.
People enjoyed themselves.
I can remember you caught the tram from Fremantle at Christmas time. From now on, say, last few weeks before Christmas.
Yeah.
And as people got off the tram, there wouldn't be a soul got off the tram didn't wish everybody a Merry Christmas.
Yeah, Merry Christmas. Yeah, that's quite
especially true. The old open trams, you know, that used to have long seats.
Yeah.
I can see Selsey blokes hanging on to them and wishing everybody a Merry Christmas as they jumped off. Yeah. War years, Ella. What was your experience of the war years?
Which war?
Last one. Oh, well, give me the first one if you like then.
Oh, the first one was all, I was four when the First World War broke out, and eight when armistice was signed. I remember armistice very clearly, because my brother-in-law had sent me a beautiful flag from British flag from France, and he died in 1917, and of course I treasured it very much, and I flew it when the armistice was signed, and someone stole it from me. And old memory.
You never hadn't seen it since?
No.
And you hadn't seen it since? Wow.
Yes. And it was a beautiful flag. It was silk.
Well,
the man used to send us all sorts of things from France, you know, different things. And
your souvenirs?
They went through the various countries.
Well, World War II was a different ball game, wasn't it? Because of Fremantle, thousands of Americans and etc.
In
Fremantle.
World War II, I was working out at Heathcote, manpower to the job out there.
As a nurse.
A nurse by profession.
Yeah.
And I was manpowered out there.
Different ball game. What's your experience at World War II, Lauren?
Well, when I was 14, I went to work. Started work at a grocery store in Fremantle with Jean Beale was the head lady there, Jean, and we lived opposite and we were great friends, and she said, oh, we need someone down there, so I went to work down there while I was 14. And what I can remember of it is having to get little white lolly bags and putting in the 2 ounces of tea or the 4 ounces of tea that was rationing, and cutting the butter into small pieces and weighing it.
All coupons.
And spices and things like that, that you know, you go in and buy your packet of spices today and you don't think that they used to be laid out in teaspoons.
Yeah.
And soap and sugar.
What things were quite an ordeal when you look back at it years ago are just taken for granted today, aren't they?
Taken for granted and wasted
there. Taken for granted.
Really.
Okay, there's just a few oddments here I'd like to ask. You remember, give me your versions, you remember Ugly Land, today's Pioneer Park.
Yeah,
I remember that. Yeah. It was still going in my day.
Yes, I remember Ugly Land on the corner of Market Street and Fillmore.
Yeah, I can remember Dad taking us down there, and there used to be wrestling and boxing and you name it. It was just like a royal, mini royal show.
Sort of.
That's for sure.
Sitting on the joy wheel.
Oh, that's for sure. And of course today it's called Pioneer Park.
Yes,
Yeah, because we've discussed the theatres, the Majestic and Princess. And King's Hall and South Terrace. Well, that was a big thing in those days, Ella, wasn't it?
What was
the King's Hall in South Terrace.
King's Hall,
because that used to be vaudeville shows and concert hall and everything, didn't it?
Yes.
It used to be a concert hall, vaudevilles and everything was held there.
Everything.
It was quite good too, wasn't it?
Very good hall.
I remember going in my youth, going in there and thinking, good, look at the size of this
sort of
thing.
Size of it,
And of course that's all gone now.
Yes, they were all my lifetime that I can remember.
Was the long jetty used for recreation when, in your young day, the Long Jetty? Remember that wharf opened up around just before the turn of the century?
Which one?
The Long Jetty off, straight off Cliff Street, you know, around the lane past Cicerolo and them places.
Yes, it was breaking up when I was working down at Watson Supply Stores in about 1926 or thereabouts. We used to go down and have our lunch on the rocks.
Oh yeah.
Feed the rats.
Yeah, well you'll find today, if you're just out from McDonald's, if you stand there where Bainers Beach, I think they call it, our early pioneer days, you can still see some pylons sticking in the water there.
How far out did it go,
Oh, I reckon it would have gone out 3/4 of a mile. A long way out. Way out. Yeah.
We used to go on it, you know, until it got a bit too dangerous.
Yeah, well it says in the history book that it was used. Once the wharf was open, it was used for recreational purposes. Now Fremantle Oval, it was originally called Barracks Green. And it was the parade ground for the convict guards just before the turn of the century. So that was around about 1894. It was changed to Fremantle Oval.
Was it really? Well,
there you go. Yeah, and of course you've probably been down there, and you remember too, Lorne, the cycle track that used to be around.
Yes.
There's a good book out called the prior to the 19th century sort of thing, and it was stated there's some good illustrations of all the old Fremantle Oval and so forth. Now, the question I'm going to ask you, Ella, is can you remember, maybe even before your day, I'm told that during the turn of the century when everyone was going mad for gold, there was insufficient accommodation in the Fremantle area to take all those who were heading for Kalgoorlie, or the goldfields I suppose I should say, and they reckon the old Fremantle trotting ground was called Tent City.
Tent City?
Tent City, I reckon.
No, Tent City was over here, the other side of Marmion Street.
On the opposite side of the trotting ground? Or?
Yes. Whereabouts?
Well, I was told it was where the Fremantle trotting ground was, but in your case you'd know if you'd seen it.
No, the Fremantle trotting ground was the polo ground. And all the bigwigs of the town and people, you might say, coming from India for playing polo, that's where it was held. Down there. This is in my lifetime.
Yeah. And Tent City was opposite.
The Tent City was what I knew of it because it gradually was built into houses. Was over there, the other side of Marmion Street.
Oh, well, then that's the south side of Marmion Street.
Of course, it might have been there, but it wouldn't have been there for any lengthy period because we used to go down and watch the polo.
Yeah, that was that's fair enough. That's a point well made.
And it was an open place until they brought the trotting ground idea along.
Well, tell me this now, Ella. Would you change anything from today to your young days? Would you like to go back to your young days, or do you think that we've improved a lot, or our method of living's improved 100%? Much better today than what it was in your young day. In other words, would it have changed over the years?
No, life has improved because there's more compassion. Generally, to say that there's more compassion in the living of people these days than there was then. It's hard to say, really, because it's evolved.
Yes.
For and against, isn't there?
There is.
Yes. There's a lot of for the living because it was more, I suppose in a way it was more caring.
I'll just give you one example. When I come to see you today, where were you? You were using your washing machine. Now you wouldn't have done that in your young day, would you?
Oh,
you'd have
the scrubbing board out. Up under the fig tree.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the old washing.
No, you see, everything has evolved. One idea, you might say, has led to another.
Mm. That's for sure.
And the general living of people has been more compassionate. Because people who were what we consider the disabled and disadvantaged people, they weren't cared for as they are today.
And you being a nurse would know
generally,
that.
Generally, they are cared for.
Mm. Tell me something in your nursing career. Whereabouts did you nurse? Didn't you travel Australia a little bit, or?
Been all over the place. And New Zealand.
And would you be a nurse again if you had the time over again?
Yes, because it was my calling. I liked it.
That's lovely, isn't it?
I kept at it until I dropped.
Yeah, because you couldn't any longer. Now, Lorne, you've been around long enough now too, also to know the changes. What's your opinion of today's compared to your youth?
Well, I had a very happy youth growing up from, say, 15 to 21, which I don't think the young people get now. I don't think they have a happy time of it at all, whether it's parents going out to work, whether they want more things than we, you know, were able to have. But we were not encumbered by any social issues.
Mm.
You know, they just weren't there. But whether that's all come about with, as my aunt says, with the evolving of things, so you get a richer tapestry of life. There's so much more in it than what we had. We were happy with simple, you know, evenings at home. They were great.
Yeah.
But now the kids have got to go out. They can't find it.
They're not home by midnight either, is it?
No, well, that's right. Nothing starts till midnight.
Yeah.
No.
No.
I'll tell you a little story.
It's very hard to say whether they're, whether you would like to have the old times back.
Well, I can tell you a little story, because my mother was just...
There's a lot of manual work in it.
Yeah, my mother just passed away at 99, and I can recall when I was courting Kath that we went to the Spearwood dance, and of course on the way home, the last bus missed the last tram from East Fremantle, shall we say. So we thought we were being smart, and we got off at the Beaky pub and walked across the monument thinking we'd get home quicker, you see. And of course when we got to the gate, who should be coming out of the front door coming down but my mother-in-law. And walking behind her was Kath's sister Mary.
Oh, yeah.
And she had a rug wrapped around her like an Indian squaw. They were coming looking for Kathy. But to this day she never ever told me where they're going to go and look. Just one of those little things, how things have changed. Well, today they'd be up at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. It's a natural thing to do.
Yes.
Now, can you think of anything that we haven't touched you'd like to bring up? I think we've covered most fields, haven't we?
We've covered most of it.
Yeah, we've covered most of the life of over the years.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, all right. Well, all I can do is say thanks to Ella. More than thank you for allowing me to come and have a talk. And also, Lorne, more than thank you too for having a discussion with us.
Been a real pleasure.
It's been lovely. Thanks, Ella. Yeah.
Things were cheaper
Thanks,
then,
Lorna.
Of course.
We didn't have as much money too.
No.
Did you?
No.
Hey?
No.
Anyhow, thank you.
Church in Blythe Street, East Fremantle. Used by Princess May School during war years, as Princess May was used as headquarters for the American forces. In the early days of WA settlement, development was hindered by the lack of a labour force. So as the convict era was closed on our east coast, our decision makers in WA asked for convict personnel to be brought to WA. Hence, from the 1850s to the 1860s, 9,600 convicts boosted WA's labour force. So the following pictures will show you some of their excellent work. More of the happenings of over the years. Prince Fremantle Boys School was built late 1800s in Adelaide Terrace, and today is at a film studio. And there's the Princess May School that was built early 1900s. these buildings are still there today. The old woman's home, the initial mental asylum, today is a lovely museum and well worth a visit. The Fremantle Station, built in the 1920s, was Fremantle's third station, still there today. Elders Building, note the turn of the century architecture. Isn't it lovely? Typical of many buildings around Fremantle. Taylor's Water Trough, donation by Mr. Taylor after two of his sons, young British migrants, passed away in Fremantle. It was built in 1905. Fremantle's first bridge over the Swan River, built 1867. Manning House, just off Fillmore Street and Packenham Street in them days. Manning, of course, was of Cockburn fame. And the park, except in Cockburn, Manning Park is named after the family. And that was built in 1863. The Roundhouse, Fremantle's first building, built in initially 1830. But note the buildings around it today, or were there in their day. There is nothing here today. First St. John's Church, built in 1843, is a site where today's town hall is. And the new church was built in the same area. Mews Boat Building area, which is where today's bathers beach is. Built in the 1840s. Long Jetty in 1873 was the hub of the Fremantle commercial life in its era. It was there till the turn of the century. First train was in March 1881. And this photo was taken in Cliff Street, Fremantle, where it was the site of one of the Fremantle railway stations. There is the station was built where that train picture was taken in the 1880s. Note the horse taxi. High Street. Town Hall opened in 1887 and the cost of the building of it was £14,000. Note the lone horseman in the street. Ella spoke of Tent City. We spoke of Tent City. And this was Tent City, built in the gold rush in just after days. Wharf construction 1896. Note the boats in the distance there. They were blasting. There was a ridge of stone right across the mouth of the Swan where it hit the ocean, and that all had to be blasted out. Immigration buildings. No doubt thousands of the elderly would remember this building in Fremantle. Irish at the Commercial Hotel in Fremantle in 1902. Did not the Irish play a big part with personnel right throughout the world? Fremantle Hospital Ward, different to the 1990s. Note the heater, note the lineup of beds. Also note how the nurses are dressed. They had hopper windows at the top note. Derby Fremantle Oval. Note the crowd. Note the dress. I think they even there's a couple of caps worn there. Fancy dress. Mills and Ware's Ball in 1916. Mills and Ware's, pioneers of the biscuits in Western Australia. Today was brought out just recently by Arnott's. Classified as a bull system, Fremantle Lumpus pickup. In them days, if you were not a good worker, you didn't get a job. If you were a troublemaker, you didn't get a job. That is what I am told. I believe that some of them used to leave a few beers for the boss at the hotel for also. Wool carting. Aren't they beautiful horses? Note the men with their aprons on. He would always bail me up when we met in town. I don't know, they must have had a brake on the wheel somehow there to stop the cart. Charabang. Off to Rockingham. These are will be mentioned by Ernie, Beth and Alf later. Or have been mentioned. The Hydrome. Al spoke of the Hydrome as his uncles were proprietors of it for many, many years. Note the post just behind the boat. Well, that was holding the shark-proof netting. One of the many posts. That's where all the crowd are more or less together there in the shark-proof. No one knew his name, or knew from where he came. They just found him dead. The top area was all dance floor. And they buried Grandpa Johnson. High Street in the 20s and 30s. Note the people. I guess it must have been a Friday or Saturday morning because the amount of people in town. But of course, them days there was no suburban shopping complexes like we have today. Also note the brand is on the shops. They were demolished in latter years. Once the tram stopped running, they had to make the streets wider. Derby Day and Depression. Sorry. No money to pay, so the cheapest way out was to stand on their bikes and look over the fence. Fremantle's first tram. Perhaps we'd be better off if we still had the trams. They did a marvellous job, and that was the last tram. Melbourne still have the trams. I think we would be better off if we still also had trams. Canning Highway, in the late 20s. My word, just have a look at it. The old Sharabank. Here's the camera man and his brother in Canning Highway, opposite where the Melbourne Bowling Club is today. Evercross Wireless Mast. Was that not a landmark over many, many years? Built in the Applecross area. Once again, close to where the Melville Bowling Club is today. Adderdale in the 1920s. You wouldn't credit that it was the same place, would you, as today? Road construction and Canning Highway. Down the hard way. My word, it would have been hard too. Canning Bridge. The second bridge. Note the old bridge on the left. Roundhouse in the 1830s. A couple of little cottages down lower. Certainly different today. The river on the right. Fremantle. In the early. They note the long jetty. Prison on the left. Note the shipping. Those in close in, that is where today's esplanade is. The shipping close ashore there, that is where today's esplanade is. Certainly a big difference. The light was filled in there between the, like an island and the buildings. That's where your wharf and railways run today. Long jetty, there's a good shot of the long jetty. Other happenings for our state of WA was the finding of gold in 1893. Hence, all over the world, personnel were heading for WA. That is the reason of our talk on Tent City, and our gold fields is still one of the biggest gold producers in the world. And of course, you must not forget the America's Cup. The late 1980s was all about the Cup. Certainly brought a lot of money to Fremantle. A very exciting time. Although development in Cockburn started in 1829, it was in the 1850s before it really started to take shape. Although it had the first town site after Fremantle, which was called Clarence, where is today's Woodman's Point, it never came to fruition. As most of the land was under pastoral leases, it all started when it was realised the richness of the land, also an excellent water supply, so the pastoral leased land was slowly subdivided into market gardens and fruit growing blocks. Fremantle Cockburn, with its industry, quarries, market gardens, fruit growers, in the 1930s was classified as the seventh richest area in the world. These areas in the early days around the turn of the century was quite multicultural, with their populations 30% English, 20% Australian born, 10% Scottish, 10% German, 8% Austrian and 1% Irish. The area of the 20s and 30s was changed with the more market garden openings up with migrants from Italy and then Yugoslavia. These areas certainly have changed with the expansion of urban development in the Cockburn area in the last 25 years. Let us now have a talk to Beth, Ernie and Alf of their story of over the years. Today is the 17th day of November 1997, and since 1829, when the first of our ships sailed into Cockburn Sound, things certainly have changed over the years. I am Alan Beale, who left the English shores in 1923 with our destination Fremantle. I was 2 years old. With me today to talk about their lives in the Cockburn region, it is with pleasure I introduce to you three people that have seen these changes over the years. Mrs. Beth Marshall, Nee Patterson, Mr. Alf Hines, Mr. Ernie McLeod. First question I'm going to ask you is, how did you become to live in Spearwood? You can start the ball rolling, Beth. Your family's...
Well, my father came out here from Scotland in 1911, I think, and Mum followed him year after. They married in Albany, and Dad settled down in Spearwood. The war broke out and he and his brother Hector enlisted in the army. I don't know how many years they were away, two or three, might be more. He came back and in the meantime Mum had a lot of worry with me, with living in dampness down in the swamp, down where St. Jerome's School is now, down in that region. So in the meantime, the people of Spearwood built a shack that was put up by a busy bee at the weekends. One weekend, I think, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And Mum and I moved in there, and I suppose I was about 3 years old. And she lived there on her own until Dad returned from the army. And from that day on, he got involved in carting stone with a horse and dray from Lime Hills down in Barrington Road, which didn't pay off too well, so he put in for a soldier settlement house, a block of land of 8 acres up in Gerald Road, and that's where I grew up.
That was your commencement of your life in Spearwood. In other words, you'd grown up, as you said.
Yeah. And it wouldn't call it a shack, though.
It was only a room and a kitchen.
A couple of rooms on a block donated by Bill Watson.
Yeah, it wasn't lined or anything.
No,
it was just
a weatherboard.
It was just for.
It was living quarters, but it was, anybody today thinking of a shack would be thinking more or less of a bush sort of business.
Well, of course, I don't remember anything about that.
It was weatherboard and a property field.
Well, how did it all start with you, Ernie? How did you start? How did your parents come to Fremantle?
Well, my father, and followed by later my brother, came from Ballarat, and they married in Kalgoorlie. Father worked up there, and he came down here to Fremantle, got a job as a superintendent tailor at the jail in Fremantle. He wrote a letter to the paper about the government, wasn't very keen on something or other. Apparently he got ticked off a little bit about what it's written. So he sort of, I think, told them what they could do with their job. And they opened up a business at 69 High Street, Fremantle, as a tailor. He was a qualified tailor.
And yourself, were you born in Ballarat or?
I was born in High Street East in Fremantle, alongside a dairy out there. A couple of brothers named Curry owned this dairy, just opposite that High Street East, by the way, or somewhere in there where this side of the golf links, the town side of the golf links. Just opposite our place, there was a little Methodist church. My first recollection of the area was, or my long-standing recollection, is that these brothers named Curry that owned this dairy, horse and cart business. At the church, of course, they were singing some, what's the name, who was it? Somebody had Sankey's songs. One of them was Courage Brothers Do Not Stumble. And my brother and I used to think it was Courage Brothers Horses Do Not Stumble. It was think that anyhow. My father opened this business and my mother had got tuberculosis. Known in those days as a consumption, and the doctor in Fremantle said that she shouldn't live there any longer. They invited my father to shift out of Fremantle and come out to some fresh air, sort of business away from town. So he bought a block, 20 acres of block up on Evelyn Road in Spearwood. And we built it. He got a settler's cottage, as they called it, from Wunderlich. And they blocked it up there on the place, and we came to live out here. That's how we started.
And what year was that, you say? What year?
1912. 1912. At the time, we had lived over another shop in Fremantle.
Yeah.
At the time. Yep. So that was how I started.
Very good. And what about you, Alf?
Well, the Hines family lived in Ray Avenue in Fremantle. That's where my father and most of his brothers were born. And as a lad of 18 years of age, he bought a block in Spearwood which was later purchased by the Packham family. And he used to ride his horse out here after work to water his fruit trees. Imagine that, from Fremantle. That's how keen he was. Anyway, he and Mother were married in 1911, and then they bought the property, which was our late property, and he built the house there, and in the meantime they lived in a shed there for 6 weeks. And during these intermittent years, Arthur and Violet and Frieda were all born. They were all born just a year apart. And my dad was a carpenter, had got quite consistent work, mainly with the public works. This is how he came to build a little school here, the Speewood School, with his brother Jim. And
church.
But at the age of 26, he was stricken down with, forget the complaint now. And from then on, he wasn't very strong. He couldn't do the roof structures and such work. And this is why he went back to the garden. Well, firstly poultry, and then market garden.
Very good, Alf. Now, fill me in on the transport. You might as well start this question. Transport in the early days.
I don't remember any transport before the silver lining.
The flash name?
The Model T. There's a Model T bus, Model T truck bus, three doors just in the side, wasn't it? And that was started off by the Hills, old man Hill.
Tiny Hill.
Yeah.
And his two sons, Bob and Charlie,
and young Tom. I don't think he did it.
There's a story behind that, you know, too.
Oh, good.
Is it clean?
Yeah.
Oh, well, tell us the story.
All right, this silver lining bus, it all said was run by Heal. Now, Heal used to run a piggery up at Hamilton Hill, and the rinderpest came out here around this area, and the whole of one of these pigs were taken away, slaughtered, and burned because they had rinderpest. And they paid a compensation. The compensation was pretty high in those days. It was considerable amount of high, and that's what we came into it. And with the money that he got out of his compensation for the destruction of these pigs, public destruction, because they were striped and the rinderpest, gave him sufficient money to buy this queer-looking animal, the Model T Ford, as Alfred said. And that length about at the end, with three doors on one side, and painted red. It was rather funny about those doors too, because I remember Mrs. Rocky, Tony Rocky, not the Rocky, the football one. She was trying to get in one side, and Piggy Heel, as they called him, Mr. Healy. He was a very, very large man, about 24 stones.
Oh, he was a big man.
Yeah, a big man. And he said to us, he turned around sideways, turned around backwards, rather, back in, Mum.
The kids all used to yell.
I think they used to call them sharabangs every day, didn't they?
The seats were thwartways, three seats only. Yeah. No iron, of course, or anything like that.
I say, didn't they call them Sharabangs them days?
Yeah, Sharabangs. And there was another one, which was the Alpine.
That came long while after, Roy years after.
Yeah, Roy Manuel.
That was run by Roy Manuel.
Roy
Manuel. His father.
His father, yeah.
And what about the trains, Beth?
Jean was the conductress on it. On the
Alpine.
On the Alpine. And when the bus service was on, they'd race each other to the stop where anybody was waiting to get on. To be first there,
you know. Well, yeah, well, there were no stops, were there? You've got to, but they'd stop wherever they saw.
Wherever they saw anybody, they'd stop.
Put up their hand.
And the Alpine driver, what I remember mostly, was Peter McLeod.
That's right.
Yeah.
Peter McLeod was a driver. And did you see where Joe died recently? His wife?
Oh, well, yes, because I got people on the ground and crowd.
Yeah, I know. And, that was the Alpine.
Well, I think one of the personnel too that had a little bit of connection with the Alpines was old Alf Pedersen, because he used to drive them through to Rockingham. He was telling us one day about it. Mm. Now what about the trains, Beth?
Oh, well, the train used to go through in the morning at about 8:30.
6 o'clock.
Beth wasn't awake then.
8:30 to go to school.
That's right.
Going to Princess
May
School.
And you were always on time?
Mostly. Yeah. And it would come in from Jandakot with a few of the girls that, and boys, of course, that went to the boys' school, and girls went to Princess May, and we'd go up through the cutting, and it would go that slow, and we'd, girls would be in one carriage and the boys in the other, and we always had to wear hats. And if you didn't look out, they'd put their hand around the carriage, take your hat off, and throw it out. And they'd have time to get out and pick it up before the train gathered speed going up the hill.
Trying to get out. We used to get out and pick up stones and throw them.
Yes. Those were the days.
And it was a great, privilege to ride in the guard there. We used to always try to get in the guard there.
And what about essential services such as doctors, hospitals, hairdressers,
barbers,
as we call the day?
Before you get on to that, I think the main business about the transport was chinks of ponies. You had to walk in and out the Fremantle.
Yeah,
if you want to go to the pictures, there were most before the buses came along, the original Silver Lining came along. You go and catch a tram from Fremantle to the south.
What about, you were telling me a little story as we were coming over in relation to push bikes. Billy Stoyer and push bikes. Now tell us that story again.
What is it?
Billy Stoyer and push bikes. Didn't Billy Stoyer or Mr. Stoyer give you a call? Mrs. Stoyer?
Oh, that was, yeah, that was during the war. When the Stoyer, three Stoyer brothers went to the war, and Bill followed up with two other brothers had gone, who were incidentally killed. And Bill left a push bike with us when he went off to the war, my brother and I, and we had much enjoyment. I used to ride that bike all over the place. And when Bill came back, he had been shot in the knee and had a stiff leg. And I remember, very naughtily possibly, thinking of it now, hoping that his knee never got better. So that he would never be able to ride his bike and we would have it. But unfortunately for us, but good luck for Bill and for all the rest of us too, Bill's leg got better and he got his bike back.
And I think throughout Bill's life in Spearwood, he was helping everybody. He would give his bike, he'd give anything.
Yeah.
He was one of the pioneers, true pioneers of
Spearwood. The Stoyer family, yes, they had a shop down at the corner for the old Rockingham Road. And what was the name of the road that came from there to
Kent Street?
Down to Baby Street. No, Kent Street ran parallel to the old Rockingham Road.
Sussex,
one of those, yeah. Mm. Down there, down where Bailey lived, between Bailey and Stoyer's house, Fletcher's as well later on.
You used to have to come around the
had a shop there.
Road to go.
It was the first Spearwood post office.
Yeah,
that, well, I was telling Glennis the other day.
The shop was also the first Spearwood post office.
Stoyer's shop was the first shop in the area, yeah. And Mrs. Stoyer, she was one of the early founders too of the Methodist Church.
Mrs. Rigby.
Parents.
Mrs. Green, don't forget Mrs. Green.
Mrs. Green, yes. We all remember
them. They were the founders of the members, the stalwarts of the Methodist Church. Mrs. Hawk, Mrs. Tony Rocky got in with afterwards as well. But those three were the real founders, I think, and then the Hines came in and all the rest of what.
Mrs.
Iam. All right, well now let's feel about the essential service. If you got sick, where was the doctor?
Doctor, what doctor?
Well, that's what I'm asking. You had to walk, didn't you?
The doctor we used to have was Dr. Birmingham from Fremantle. He had a motor car, number one, and he used to drive out here to any of his patients and what. He used to come out to our place, I know. He attended me a couple of times, and he was the one that suggested ordering my mother out to live out here. And he used to have come out quite frequently to attend to her until they sent her up to Waterloo to the criminal, to the, what's the name, to the sanatorium up there. He was the only doctor that I knew that came out. Now other people may have had other doctors, but there was no doctor apart from the Fremantle.
What about Dr. Kerr? Do you remember him?
Dr. Kerr came later, yes.
He came out to me
once. He was the one that operated on my father.
I had grapes, too many grapes.
You had. You had eaten too many grapes.
And I was terribly sick that night.
So I couldn't imagine
if the doctor had to go up to the top of Phoenix Road to guide him down to where we were. You know, Phoenix Road and Gerald Road came up. Because he didn't have a clue where we lived.
And what about hospitals, Al?
We never had any connection with hospital. We were all born in the house. There was a...
in the house?
Yeah.
Midwives.
There was a midwife, wasn't there? Nurse Barton, was she a midwife?
I think I remember that.
Or was Sister Salmon? Nurse Salmon?
Yeah, Nurse
Salmon. Yeah, well, they used to do the rounds and deliver the babies.
Yeah.
And our family...
Nurse Sheeting, was she?
Yeah, she was still there at Beansville.
We didn't know, have any connection with the doctors or hospitals.
Nurse O'Grady's.
Oh,
and of course, if you got sick, you went to Fremantle Hospital.
That's right.
That's right. And that was a public hospital, by the way. It was a public hospital, not a state, a government hospital. And the money raised to run that was by the people of Fremantle and districts. Raised money by running concerts and sales of chocolate cakes and all sorts of things. My father was on the board of that later on, and later the chairman of it, and none of them ever got paid for that until it became a government hospital when they were paid for a sitting, and all the mob that had been in were trying to get on, used to get on the mayor of Fremantle and those were trying to get on the board because they got money for it. But in the early days, we had to do IRAM concerts. I was on theatre in Fremantle, used to play at the town hall to raise money for the Fremantle Hospital. And that was our only medical supply.
Now, what about your groceries?
Yeah, well, Stroyer's were the first ones to start, followed by Rose, right by the station there.
Who was the first one?
Stroyer. Stroyer's had their little shop down there, and Rocky, the corner of Rocky and Road, and not so succeeded, but one of the, And then Rose built right alongside the station, directly.
The butcher shop.
No, Rose's
shop was there.
Rose came down from there. He was in China for many years. He
started
running around the world himself in the Chinese dress. And they ran a shop there for years and years and years. They had also had a tennis court, the first tennis court of this year. And then later on, the butcher shop came.
Yeah.
That was much later. That was the, what's the name?
George Berry.
Yeah, the Berry, George Berry and his two sons. His sons didn't run it to the start, they didn't finish.
What about Bayes,
Ben? There's that one that came down, McCleary, wasn't it? That ran the shop opposite the school, a part of Stroyer Block.
It was a co-op.
No, but it started with two people around it.
Oh, I don't know that.
A husband and wife, either McKinnon or McCleary or something like that. A husband and wife. And then sold out, that turned to people in Hibbon.
Well, the Hines brothers had it for a term.
That's Hines brothers.
Not my father, but his three brothers, George and Bert.
That's right.
They used to live around the Spears Co-op. I never knew whether they sold to Mrs. Hibbert. She was
no, there. I think, you remember Kay? Kay, do you remember Kay? He was in that shop. Kay. In the school store. And then I think Mrs. Hibbert took it on after all.
Yeah, she was there very early because she was there when I was in school.
Yes, that's right. We used to go over there and the only thing you could buy for your lunch was Mills and Ware's biscuits, the broken biscuits. We got the thrippins, we got a whole bag full.
Alf, what can you tell us about Dowie Hanson?
Have
we got enough time?
No, I just remember Dowie Hanson really is the master of ceremonies at the local dances. Of course, the family was the Spearwood Bakery and they used to deliver. And Mr. Hanson too was a big man, wasn't he?
Yeah,
he was a big German.
He was a big man, and so was Harry.
And
What nationality was this?
German.
German, I thought they were.
Yeah, but Harry was a real live warrior. He was always on the go, always in a hurry. Only a little man, but he had a big voice.
He'd start off the dance, he'd go right round the hall dancing by himself, getting everybody in up. At the old parish.
But they, when they first came out here, they got, as I say, he was a big man. He looked like the old Beale Hall type of man.
Yeah,
his side.
Yeah.
The wife was much smaller, as usual, fairly skinny little woman.
He's thin.
And the son was the funniest looking person you'd ever seen in your life.
Yeah.
He had a very skinny body and a short body, but a head on him, an enormous big head and seam. And great big ears and stood out like Dumbo.
He did too.
And he was a queer looking person, and he used to ride his bike into Fremantle. If the school out here wasn't good enough for them at the time, they must have been bought somewhere else. Not a Catholic school or private school in Fremantle. And he used to ride in them, and for his school bag they had a hide from some animal from Jim they brought out on a roll, and used to sit on his back, and he used to drive that in for his school now.
Yeah.
George Everly worked for him as a baiter. They were a very, very good baiter, they were terrific, very good. And then, little Dowie, Harry, when he got away from his school, or he while he was at school, he had the help of his father. But later on, he left school, he ran the baiter's cart out here.
He did the deliveries.
I know he used to pay me something sometimes to get him a hand.
Yeah, I can recall when we first moved to Naval Base or Hope Valley in 1934, Wally Gordon was working for Dowie then in the horse and cart, because
right.
They used to go out through the Peel Estate and they used to deliver your bread, your meat, your mail,
that's right.
You name it, and they delivered it. And it wasn't until when I was making the tape in 88 of the district that I inquired about a little building that was behind his shop, and evidently it's got had a very steep roof, and evidently he had a well down there which basically was a cellar where he used to keep all his perishables down to keep it cool as possible.
He had ice works too, I think.
Yes,
he had ice also, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. Mm. No, he was...
Well, that all came much later, wasn't it? That's not the early. That wasn't the early. Well,
you can remember 20 years before I can.
Yes, that's right.
You remember before me too.
Yeah.
And Beth, what about Bailey's store?
Bailey's store?
Hmm.
Well, Bailey's store sold everything. Chaff for the...
That was Rose.
Rose and Bailey. Rose and
Bailey,
yeah.
Oh, Bailey's. Well, they just took over from...
Rose.
Yeah, they
You mean Andy Bailey?
No, the Bailey's store. Where Reg used to work from Wally.
Yeah, that's right. Mm. Well, they took over from Rose. They sold out to...
This is the Florrie Row that we said was here 2 years ago.
Oh yeah.
Mm. And she's just died recently.
Mm-hmm.
She was the postmistress there until Bailey's came and then packed it all that to delivery, getting the letters sorted out, you know, and we had to go and collect our mail.
Well, then once again, that's another point. You see, you had to collect your mail, or someone would collect it for you. There was no posting.
No.
They were the post office.
The post office.
The bag used to be thrown off the train, Alan.
Pardon?
Thrown off in a bag.
As the train came over the road, the bag would be thrown off and somebody would be there to pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
I went and picked it up many a time, lug it into Pat, and then she'd take a half an hour and sort things out.
Yeah.
And I had a mail round. I had a mail round up our street. Tiley, Mayor,
Packham,
Smart. I did the lot. And I used to get threepence from this one and sixpence from that one. I was at a couple of bob when I was 10 years old.
You were a capitalist, Al. You were a capitalist.
Yeah.
That's how I started to become a millionaire, wasn't it?
That was the start.
Well, the eldest son of Bailey's committed suicide.
Yeah, that was Jack.
Yeah, the eldest son.
Yeah, that was very sad. But tell me,
nobody knows why.
Tell me, Ernie,
Give
us a few briefs on your dad. He was a pretty popular chap around the area. He seemed to be in all those things. He was the founder of the PNC. And tell us a little history.
My father was an immigrant. He was totally immigrant at all. Before he came out here, he was he started off with the Australian Natives Association. He was chairman, president of that, the general president of Australia, and he came out here, and the first thing he did was to go on the Fremantle Road Board as a member. He later on finished up as chairman of it. He joined the Progress Association the 30th of June 1914. The Beale School was open, and the Minister of Education came out here and to open the school. My father was on the what is known as the State School Board then, of which there were three members of the Reverend Hamlin from the Presbyterian Church at Fremantle was one member, my father the other. I can't think of the name of the third one. Anyhow, because of this business, my father was called upon to do a bit of talking, or was arranged rather beforehand, but he'd do something or other. And he announced at that time that they were going to form a parents' association to help the school. Now, at that particular period, there was a chap named Captain, a Dutchman, who had jumped ship some time previously, had come out to live in Beale, had a house and railway, had a block lower and railways.
Railway parade,
yeah. And he became a market gardener like the rest of the people around here. But he never married, of course, he had no children. But he was a man that wanted to be in his sister districts. He used to be in the Progress Association, by having the fruit grove. And because of this, he wasn't able to join any parents' association. So my father suggested he was going to form a parents and citizens association to allow those who never had children going to school who wanted to assist to join. And that parents and citizens association lives today throughout the state. On top of that, to say he was on the road board for many years and finished up as chairman. He also was on the Fremantle Hospital Board, finished up as chairman of that. And at one stage of the game, when there was apparently a bit of a shortage, he took over a secretaryship of the Fruit Growers Association for a short time. And if there's any help in the district that I haven't thought of.
He used to
write the steward notes for the Fremantle Land Brigade. And when he dropped it over, I took over from it. I remember land based in the Rose Board.
Yeah.
In this the father, he was the first Scottish colony down here. As I said, if there's an organisation that didn't have Angus McLeod poking his bill around somewhere.
I think he was the chairman of the soccer club too at one stage.
Yes, well, as a matter of fact,
there's
a point there, I don't think I remember this, and I can't, but first of all, he started with one of that for football, but he stopped, remember him sticking some goalposts in our own paddock, which was on a bit of a slope at the time too. And I know he got me to come out and cut some oats so that they had there to grow so that they could play football. And he made, as a tailor, he made the uniforms for the leaders. They were made out of a sort of a galatea stuff, something like a dungaree, a light dungaree type of thing. And they were lace-ups with short sleeves, with blue with a gold band across them. Now, I remember that was the first soccer club, or the first footy club. The footy didn't last a great deal of time, but later on he got a name.
He might have made those shirts for the Caledonian Soccer Club. Well, I had a phone call today by a chap that's writing a book, and he said their first shirts were similar to what you were talking about. The colours come from Tasmania. So he could have been the tailor that made those shirts for the Kellys first up, you know?
Yeah, well, he donated them. He made them himself and donated them. It was his idea. I think the idea of that, probably because he came from Victoria, where football started, that was the type of uniform they used to wear, apparently. It wasn't the jerseys, it was just the type of thing with all the lace stuff.
Mm.
But I can't remember whether it was when he was trying to encourage a football club there, or whether it was done for the soccer club. But the football never got him too well. Soccer did, went on ahead later on. But they also played cricket here, Smart Paddock. They played football as well. In fact, I can remember seeing one of Australia's test players, Clem Hill, bowler, and that's been playing up there.
In Smart Paddock?
Yep.
Well, that was a finger in that feather in their cap. Yeah, that was a feather in their cap. Yep, now Beth, Archie. Now, as he was known to us all, we all called him Archie, over the years he was one of the really truly helpful pioneers. As your dad, tell us about him.
Well, my dad was a man that liked to be in a lot of things, like he was in the RSL, he was in the Freemasons, and he also was very, very keen on the Spearwood Rovers Soccer Club, which was president for a little while. And owing to his very broad Scottish accent, I think sometimes they couldn't altogether understand him. So he got his son-in-law, my husband, to take over that, and he nicely got out of it. There was never a game played.
He was getting on in years.
He was always there, Beth. He was always there.
He was always there.
I have photos in my scrapbook.
And he always said there was no club like the Spearwood Soccer Club. Mm. And for one person that he had the most time, I will say this, and I don't want to embarrass him, but he reckoned there was no footballer or centre forward like Alan Beale.
Well, thanks, Beth. Thank you.
He always said that.
Do you recall what year was it? I was telling Ernie about it when Dad went back to Scotland for a trip. What year was that?
Oh, now. Ellis would be about 6, I suppose. Maybe 50 years ago. Now,
yeah.
He'd been gone over 30.
Because I can recall having to talk to him at the first game, when he was home, the first game sort of thing that was playable, he was there on the fruit growers.
Yeah.
And I had a talk to him about things going. He says, you know, he says, I could watch games in Scotland, I could watch this, I could watch that. He said, but I never got the enjoyment from just standing here on the side here watching Spearwood Rovers. Mm-hmm. It's incredible.
He knew everybody's play, and I always remember when Lenny Pearson was the goalkeeper. And Lenny Pearson was really timid to start with. And Dad went down, not that he was ever a footballer in his day, but he knew it. And we always got papers, Scottish papers, sent. My aunt always sent them out to Mum. And he always studied them a bit. And he used to talk to Lenny Pearson down at the goal, what he thought he would do. Not that he said he wasn't a professional at that, but he would sort of give him a bit of advice.
And encouragement.
He knew Alf from a little boy, and he thought the world was a soccer club.
I can remember when we were 1939, we were down the Busselton Carnival, and we had a pretty strenuous time, and we come off the park at 1:30, and to qualify for the final, we had to go back on at 3:00 against Vic Park, who was a top team in First Division soccer in them days.
Yeah.
And we get back to the hostel, or I suppose it would have been Elf, and there was Billy Stroy, your dad, Sid Schofield, and old Pop Nolan, I think it was, and Frank Packham.
Yeah.
They had two or three bars in the guest house, and they had them all full of hot water and a few bottles of vinegar in every one of them, and we all had to get through this, but needless to say, we still got beat. We put up a pretty good show. But anyhow, that's lovely, Beth. Now, Elf, over the years I've had the pleasure to grow up with you, a true blue mate, both on and off the soccer field. Your family, including uncles, have been great pioneers for our Fremantle Cockburn region. What else can you tell us about them all?
Well, Jim Hines, as I said, he was the master builder. He lived just up the street from us, the house which was later bought by the Grillersitches. And my father thought the world of him and worked for him as a carpenter. Jim eventually moved to East Fremantle. But the other brothers, apart from having a short time down at the Spearwood Co-op, and speaking of Alf, George and Bert, they went down into the hydrodrome, which was about 1933.
Mm.
And they had the hydrodrome at South Beach for 8 years, which proved quite a good business apparently, and the sisters and I used to go there on holidays and all spare time and work for them, get a few bob.
And how were they tied up with these camps at Point Perrin?
Well, that was entirely Alf. He was always a very outgoing man during the Depression. He ran soup kitchens at the Fremantle.
He's a wonderful worker for Fremantle
Oval.
You remember Alf Lyons, don't you?
He just, for some reason, he just took an interest in the crippled children. And
he was a warrior.
He had camps at Point Walter and he had a camp at Garden Island. This is different years.
Mm.
And eventually the camp down at Palm Beach was built and named after him. Stands today as the Alfred Hines Seaside Home for Crippled Children, and it's still very active, still being occupied by numerous disabled groups at different times of the year, which is a great thing.
Yes.
But he worked, and during the war he was given the OBE for his efforts in entertaining sailors, mainly with entertainments, when the ships were in port, arranging dances and all that sort of thing. He was just a tireless worker, always helping people.
And those that needed help, wasn't it?
Absolutely. And Bert, he never married, Bert, and he was always in the background. He was always doing the supplies and he was off servant, but he wasn't one to seek the limelight.
Yes, those were the days, weren't they?
Yeah. They help,
people help. The funny part about it is Marlon's out.
This was very, very prominent during the Depression.
Yes.
Out here during the Depression and in the 30s, everybody gave help, didn't they?
Yes.
You had some good plants and eggs. Marlon's out here.
And we had to swap things around.
Yes.
And Watson's had a lot of milk and cream, and anybody that didn't have
anything. There was
anything,
a lot of big families that didn't have any money, any income.
I mean, everybody was friendly.
Yeah. Everybody hopped in and helped all over the place, apart from all the charitable things that they did, like help. They carried on their own private businesses, like their little, my father's running his tailor shop, people out here running their gardens and so on.
Yeah.
They did that, and they didn't stop doing something to do something else.
No.
They managed to fit it all in.
Fit it all in.
It weren't enough hours a day.
Also, the social life was very good. What the parents and citizens.
We used to have picnics up at the Steward Hall, which was before the current hall was built. Mm. There was a little stone hut up there. The Church of England used to run the church up there next to where Brindsey's. Right along Brindley's fence.
Oh, yes.
And that was the first church my father took when there was no.
Where was the Armstrong?
My people, father was Presbyterian,
mother was
Jenny.
Methodist.
Yeah.
You told me that.
But he took me to the church.
Mm.
I think they've still got that there, haven't they?
Yes.
The little church where we used to go to the dances.
Yeah. No, a little
parish
stone
hall.
Place.
There's a little church about as big as this room. Down the hill a bit.
Yes.
Yeah, it might be gone now.
Just the sand floor. Sand floor.
George used it as a storeroom for many years.
Then they had the parish hall, of course.
George Brindsey built a house right next to that.
That's right.
Yes, well, there was no George Brindsey in my day. The father of Brindsey was never married. He had an Italian flag over his smoky open fireplace. I used to go up there and talk to him.
Old
Joe Brindsey. Old
Joe Brindsey,
the original, the old man.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's all gone now. The old house and all the whole the area now is all gone. And in other words, this
Brindsey's house, the asbestos place, that's all gone. They're filling all that swamp in.
To just drive around that one your way home, Elvis Worth.
It's all been made into blocks.
Originally they lived in a stone place along the fence.
Yeah, that's all gone.
Incidentally, Alan, you were talking a while ago, we were talking about Dowie Hanson. Of course, he got his nickname Dowie because of his father being the baker and him running around delivering. But we used to have, the district used to run family picnics up at this where the parish hall is now. It wasn't in existence in those days. And you all took, they all took their tucker up and they all drove up in their horses and carts. And one of the races for the kids and things, one of the races they had was not only for kids. There was a road race, a bike race, going from the hall down round across the railway line on the Rockingham Road, down to Bailey's Corner, turn left, to Stoyer's Corner, turn left again, come back on the old Rockingham Road, up to back to the picnic ground,
yeah.
Just opposite Smart's paddock. And Dowie Hanson was a joke of the star on the bike, he had a bike. And as I was told, he used to ride his bike to school every day in Fremantle. And he was considered a bit of a joke, this skinny little bloke,
yeah,
getting on the bike. And he rode so fast, he got so far ahead of the never could catch him up, and he finished with the thing half an hour more or less. That was quite some considerable time before anybody else had won it like mad. Fell off the bike and collapsed.
Mm.
But he won it. Little skinny doughy.
Yeah, little skinny doughy. Well, anyhow, folk, Beth, Ernie and Alf, thank you for giving me your time to talk about your experiences over the years.
Thank you.
I think we've pretty well covered most things. We could keep talking for hours. But thanks, Ern.
Yeah.
Thanks, Beth.
Thank you,
Alf.
Thank you.
As we have just been talking to Beth, Ernie and Alf, let me show you where they live. This was the McLeod residence in Edeline Road, Spearwood. Place is now classified in our National Trust. I noticed the roof is missing on the upstairs section. This is the present day school in Gerald Road, Spearwood, the property where Beth's family lived after World War I. And unfortunately, with the urban development, their place went. Now, I'm showing you here, this was actually the original fruit growers. All this area you're looking at now was the fruit growers. Their back fence was the Patterson back fence. In other words, and this is where the grapevines were that Beth was talking about, which when she ate too many she had problems. Now we're across to the Hines, where the Hines residence was. This is the area where they had their market garden. That two-story home you see there is where they had a beautiful limestone home. It was a beauty, and they say progress. I think it was knocked down for a home such as that is a nice home. The Hines home was real heritage. All this area here now is on the drawing board for development, possibility of another big highway coming through this region. One of the first group meetings of note was the forming in 1913 of the Fruit Growers and Market Gardeners Association. The founder was Mr. Andy Bailey, who lived on the corner of today's Kent Street and Sussex Street. And their first president was a man who had been the district's saviour on many occasions with district projects. No other than the founder of today's Watsonia, Bill Watson. The land that the building of our present Civic Centre offices and our library was purchased by the fruit growers in the 1920s. And a hall known as the Fruit Growers Hall was erected on the site. On the 20th of March 1963, the fruit growers handed the land over for council development for their headquarters. In other words, you could say market gardeners and fruit growers donated the land for the district's development. Yes, all it cost us ratepayers was a mere £500. Yes, a gift from the people of Cockburn. So us oldies consider it a sacred site. Remembrance to our pioneers. So future generations, please look after it with pride. We have many leaders in the Fremantle Cockburn region. I have mentioned Mr. Watson, Mr. Frederick Sampson, Mr. Angus MacLeod, whose son spoke well on over the years. You could fill a book on our leaders. To them, let's say thank you for everything you have done to make Fremantle Cockburn a lovely place for us all to live. Isn't this beautiful site of the Cockburn Sound, where our first ships came in 1829. This is the Coogee Beach area here, and as you see, the old Rob's Jetty area, the old powerhouse area, they're all up at the present moment. There's the old anchorage, they're all up for redevelopment. No doubt I would say inside of 20 years you'll have another big major highway going across this area. Yes, this land was all market gardeners and fruit growing. Certainly changed over the years. As you can see, there's Darling Ranges in the background. In the distance here, you can see Fremantle. Garden Island, which is today the naval base, headquarters to the West Australian section of the Australian Navy. Fremantle, Cockburn, over the years. I hope you have enjoyed this tape as much as I have enjoyed bringing it to you. God bless. Alone the golden mile.